this on? Yes. Hello. Welcome back. Come back. Sit down. Get ready for the final session.
Hey.
Okay. Sit down. Shut up. Get ready to listen. So this is the final session. I agree that whoever said it got chaotic in the last panel. I think they sort of fatigue was setting in, and I'm also guilty as a curator of letting the subject rove too widely from the original remit. So I have learned something here as an amateur curator. So the final session is with Annie Dorsen, who I am pleased to have here from New York.
Thank you very much.
Annie is trained in theatre, so we all come from different disciplinary backgrounds today. But Annie, tell us how this piece came about, this Spokaoke.
First I just want to say thank you so much to Rietveld for having me and to Claire for the invitation. It's been a very excellent few days. This actually started in a way. There's one very immediate story, like the immediate catalyst. I was in a karaoke bar late at night with a friend, and he absolutely wouldn't sing under any circumstances because he said his voice was too bad, you know, which never really stopped me. But he was super shy, and I thought, you know, oh, there should be a karaoke for people who don't want to sing. And of course, once I started thinking about it further, it seemed that there was actually quite a lot of interesting things in the notion of doing a karaoke of speeches as opposed to songs. So that's kind of the immediate catalyst. It really came from a sort of embarrassment on his part. But in a larger sense, you know, I come really from theater, but really from theater. I went to Yale School of Drama, and I directed plays, and I even directed a musical. And in 2008, I kind of left all of that happily behind. And since then, I really don't work with actors anymore. That was one of the reasons why I wanted to leave theater, is because I really can't stand actors. This is very different from most of my work, which involves, I use computer algorithms to generate theater performance in real time. And this one is a little different. You know, I sort of never thought that I would do a participation piece for ethical reasons. But I did, you know. But what's nice, of course, is that then it's another way of getting at some issues of, I don't know, embodiment and representation and the use of language on stage and all of these things without having to deal with actors.
And often many of these speeches, we know just maybe a famous, you know, one or two lines or phrases from things. Like when we were practicing it last night, we had JFK doing the Ich bin ein Berliner speech. But, you know, what does he say in the rest of that speech? You know, who knows? So it's an opportunity to also hear some great speeches from political history, but also, as you say, to embody them, to you know, occupy that position yourself, which, as you'll see, is not an easy or comfortable task. Yeah? And I remember you saying to me that this is often quite an uncomfortable performance piece. Yeah, so I'm encouraging you all to drink. I've got tequila for people who are about to take to the podium and speak into the microphone. But that it's actually all quite awkward.
Yeah, it can be pretty awkward. So have fun. I'm kind of a nerd. I mean, it's also kind of a nerd piece, I have to say. I studied history. That's really my academic training, such as it is. And then went on to study theater directing. It was really both a kind of heaven and hell making this piece, because on the one hand, I got to completely geek out over all the great pieces of rhetoric I could find and all the sort of most famous speeches and these wonderful old books that they used to publish of, you know, the great collected rhetoric of, you know, whoever. And then on the other hand, you know, it was a kind of a hell, because all the software that is available to make karaoke speeches is incredibly shitty. Making each speech took absolutely forever, and you can never perfect it, you know? So this nice, kind of crap quality that we're used to with karaoke is well represented here. And that also, you know, so there's also something with these speeches, performing them, it's awkward sometimes because the speeches are a bit different than what you thought they would be, or because it's you find yourself saying things that you would never in a million years say, or But sometimes it's just awkward because actually the performance situation is sort of odd, you know, because the words are kind of moving in a certain, anyway, you'll see. Should we just go for it?
Yes, just one more thing. I mean, I also thought about what putting this piece would mean in the context of an educational establishment. And so I remember right at the beginning, I pinged an email to you going, do you ever see this piece as educational in any way? And you came back to me with an interesting story.
I did.
Well, okay. That you tried to market it to public schools in New
York.
Yeah,
oh, that. Yeah, last night. So I did have the thought that this would be a really great way of kind of like, you know, I could make a little package that I could sell around to school systems or something like this, and it would be kind of a fun thing for high school students to do in history class. But I didn't pursue it because, it's so bureaucratic, those things, that it would really be like a full-time job trying to find my way in there.
So even though that didn't work here, maybe it's something, I think.
I mean, I like the thing that you said, you know, Claire wrote in an email, she said, like, can this be a rehearsal for public speaking, for political speech? I kind of like that notion, even though it wasn't in my mind. But I like that notion also because so many of the speeches, I mean, at a certain point, like in 1950 or so, all the speeches are kind of from television or films or whatever, but everything before that, you know, it's these very embodied situations. A lot of the speeches originally took place. It's just person to person on the street or at the train station or, you know, Elizabeth I going down to talk to the sailors. And that's a really nice thing, I don't know, maybe coming out of our recent experiences in Occupy, where again, this kind of embodied mode of address, just body to body, was practiced again after quite a long time when people weren't really doing that. So,
and then I'm also going to use this as an opportunity to just wrap up the day as a whole by just saying, I think we've moved from is everyone a performer to is everyone an amateur? And as you'll see over the next hour, everyone is really going to be an amateur. And also to tie it back to the theme of my book, which the whole few days have been organized around, this I think is really a quintessential artificial hell that we're about to go into. So with that, I'm going to encourage the first person to come up. And I'm afraid we vetoed the first person, Jurgis Juan, as being two people. And we're going to move straight on to the next one, which is Dionysus, who is going to do speech number 84, which is Socrates, I believe.
Socrates. It's great to start with Socrates.
So, Dionysus, if you'd like a shot of tequila.
Judges, be of good cheer about death, and know this is of a truth, that no evil can happen to a good man, either in life or after death. He and his are not neglected by the gods, nor has my own approaching end happened my mere chance. But I see clearly that die and be released was better for me, and therefore the oracle gave me no sign. For which reason also I'm not angry with my accusers or my condemners. They have done me no harm, although neither of them meant to be any good, and for this I may deadly blame them. Still, I have a favor to ask for them. When my sons are grown up, I would ask you, oh my friends, to punish them, and would have you troubled as I have troubled you, if they seem to care about riches or bitches or anything more than about future, or if they pretend to be something when they are really nothing, they reprove themselves as having reproved you for not caring about that for which they ought to care, and thinking that they are something when they are really nothing. And if you do this, and my sons will have received justice at your hands. There, hour of departure has arrived and we go our ways. I die and you do live. Which is better, God only knows.
For the beginning of this event. So the next we have Julia, who is going to be doing the Pope. Julia.
So this is the Pope. Very exciting.
So this is the Pope's instruction to crusaders.
Although, O Son of God, you have promised more firmly than ever to keep the peace among yourselves, to preserve the right of the Church, there remains still an important work for you to do. Freshly quickened by the divine correction, you must apply the strength of your righteousness to another matter which concerns you as well as God. For you, your brethren, living days are the urgent need of your help, and you must hasten to give them the aid which had often been promised them. For, as the most of you have heard, the Turks and the Arabs have attacked them and have conquered the territory of Romania, as far west as the shore of the Mediterranean and the Hellespont, which is called the Arm of St. George. They have occupied more and more of the lands of those Christians and have to overcome them in seven battles. They have killed and captured many and have destroyed the churches and devastated the empire. If you permit them to contend thus for a while with impunity, the faithful of God would be much more widely attacked by them. On this account, I, or rather the Lord, beseech you as Christ's herald to publish this everywhere and to persuade all the people of whatever rank, foot soldiers and knights, poor and rich, to carry aid promptly to these Christians to destroy that vile race from the lands of our friends. I say this to those who are present. It is meant also for those who are absent. Moreover, Christ commands it. Who died by the way, whether by land or by sea, or in battle against the pagans, shall have immediate remissions of sins. This I grant them through the power of God, which I am invested. Oh, what a disgrace if such a despised and base race, which worship demons, should conquer a people which has the faith of omnipotent God and is made glorious with the name of Christ. With what reproaches will the Lord overwhelm us if you do not aid those who with us profess the Christian religion? Let those who have been accustomed unjustly to wage private warfare against the faithful now go against the infidels and end with victory this war which should have been begun long ago. Let those who for a long time have been robbers now become knights. Let those who have been fighting against their brothers and relatives now fight in a power way against the barbarians. Let those who have been serving as mercenaries for small pay now obtain the eternal reward. Let those who have been wearing themselves out of both body and soul now work for a double honor. Behold, on this side will be the sorrowful and poor, on that the rich, on this side the enemies of the Lord, on that his friends. Let those who not go to put off the journey but rent their lands and collect money for their expenses, and soon as winter is over and spring comes, let them eagerly set out the way which with God as their guide.
bit of Christian propaganda there from Pope Urban II, imploring people to kill Muslims in return for Christian salvation. But you can also see how long a four-minute speech really feels when you're up there. So next we have Alina, who is going to be doing Ronald Reagan's Mr. Gorbachev. Take down that wall speech. This is a speech given at the Brandenburg Gate in 1987. So we're at. Cheers.
Very good. That's not amateur at all. All right. Let's maybe go. Now. The Soviets themselves may, in a limited way, be coming to understand the importance of freedom. Oh, damn it. We hear much from Moscow about a new policy of reform and openness. Some political prisoners have been released. Certain foreigners' news broadcasts are no longer being jammed. Some economic enterprises have permitted to operate with greater freedom from state control. Are these the beginnings of profound changes in the Soviet state? Or are they token gestures intended to raise false hopes in the West? Or to strengthen the Soviet system without changing it? We welcome change and openness, for we believe that freedom and security go together, that the advance of human liberty in the cause of world peace. There is one sign the Soviets can make that would be unmistakable. That would advance dramatically the cause of freedom and peace. General Secretary Gorbachev, if you seek peace, if you seek prosperity for the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, if you seek liberalization, come here to this gate. Mr. Gorbachev, open this gate.
Speech. I'm experienced now, which is for the press conference before the famous rumble in the jungle.
He's benefiting. There I live again, just like I come in, beating a big bad monster who knock at everybody and no one can whop him? That's for the little stop Sonny. He was a god. But he taller than George. His reach is longer than George. He's a better boxer than George. I'm better than now. I was when you saw that 22 years old. Understand, but running fast. So now, professional Joe is being broken, being knocked down a couple of times. I'm bad. The alligator? That's right. I have a room. A Duncan lightning through from danger, that's bad. Interest, though. A brick. I'm so mean. My medicine is sick. Fast. Last night I cut the light off my barrel, hit the switch, was in the bed before the river stuck fast. good from the other level than I want him. All of you, I know you got him, I know you got him. But man's trouble, I'm also showing you how good I am.
And you want to add your name to the list, I'm just saying, pen and paper's here. So next up we have Vidya, who is going to come and do the Miss South Carolina Teen USA speech. So, and it's called Education Question. This is the difficult question of this South Carolina, well, any Miss World, the education question is a difficult question.
Yeah, it's all right.
Recent polls have shown a fifth of Americans.
Why do you think it is? I personally believe that US Americans are unable to do so. Because some people out there in our nation don't have maps. And I believe that our education, like such as South Africa and the Iraq, everywhere like such as, and I believe that they should, our education over here in the US should help the US. Or should help South Africa and should help the Iraq and the Asian countries, and we will be able to build our future for.
Thank you very much, South Carolina.
Harvey Milk speech. You've got to give them hope. Harvey Milk, as you know, first openly gay person to be elected to public office in California. It's from 1978.
Somewhere in Des Moines or San Antonio, there's a young gay person who all of a sudden realizes that he or she is gay. Knows that if their parents find out, they will be tossed out of their house. Their classmates will taunt the child, and the Anita Bryans and the John Briggs are doing their bit on TV. And that the child has several options, staying in the closet and suicide. And then one day the child might open the paper and that says, homosexual elected in San Francisco. And there are two new options. The option is to go to California or stay in San Antonio and fight. 2 days after I was elected, I got a phone call and the voice was quite young. It was from Altoona, Pennsylvania. And the person said, thanks. And you've got to elect gay people so that the young child and the thousands upon thousands, like that child, know that there is hope for a better world. There is hope for a better tomorrow. Without hope, not only gays, but those who are blacks, the Asians, the disabled, the seniors, the uses. Without hope, the uses give up. I know that you can't live on hope alone, but without it, life's not worth living. And you've got to give them hope. Thank you very much.
So now I'd like to call up Frederica. It's going to be Bill Clinton's I Have Sinned speech. Now, we've had reference to this earlier today by Alexandra, and now it's time to hear this speech from 1998 that was given at the National Prayer Breakfast.
Yeah.
I agree with those who said that in my first statement, after I testified, I was not contrite enough. I don't think there is a fancy way to say that I've sinned. It's important to me that everybody who's been hurt now, that the sorrow I feel is genuine. First and most important, my family. Also my friends, my staff, my cabinet, Monica Lewinsky, and her family, and the American people. I've asked all for their forgiveness. But I believe that to be forgiven, more than sorrow is required. At least two other things. First, genuine repentance. A determination to change and to repair breaches of my own making. I have repented. Second, what my Bible calls a broken spirit. An understanding that I must have God's help to be the person that I want to be. A willingness to give the very forgiveness that I seek. A renunciation of the pride and anger which cloud judgment, lead people to excuse and compare and to blame and complain. I'm very grateful for the many, many people, clergy and ordinary citizens alike, who have ridden me with wise counsel. I'm profoundly grateful for the support of so many Americans who somehow, through it all, seems to still know that I care about them a great deal, that I care about their problems and their dreams. I am grateful for those who have stood by me and who say that in this case, and many others, the bounds of privacy have been excessively and unwisely invaded. That may be. Nevertheless, in this case, it may be a blessing because I still sinned. And if my repentance is genuine and sustained, and if I can maintain both a broken spirit and a strong heart, then good can come this for our country, as well as for me and my family.
Next up, by the way, you know, we only have three more people scheduled, so get ready to get up and perform. All I can say. So the next one is Mariana. Mariana, come on down. Mariana is going to do Sermon to the Birds by St. Francis of Assisi from 1220 AD.
My little sisters, the birds, much bounden are ye unto God, your Creator, and always, in every place, ought ye to praise Him, for that He hath given you liberty to fly about everywhere, and hath also given you double and triple raiment. Moreover, He preserved your seed in the ark of Noah, that your race might not perish out of the world. Still more are ye beholden to Him for the element of the air which He hath appointed for you. Beyond all this, ye sow not, neither do you reap. And God feedeth you and giveth you the streams and the mountains and the fountains for your drink, the mountains and valleys for your refuge, and the high trees whereon to make your nests. And because ye know not how to spin or sew, God clotheth you and your children. Wherefore your Creator loveth you much, seeing that He hath bestowed on you so many benefits. And therefore, my little sisters, be aware of the sin of ingratitude, and study always to give praises unto God.
Now, next up we have, are you next? Or are you going to write? You want to write next? Excellent, this is what we need to see.
Yeah.
Now, there's also a name here that I can't read. What does this say?
Alex?
Alessa? Alex?
Alex?
Anyway, doing the speech by George Best.
Oh, yes.
Who was that? Yes. Come on up.
Wonderful.
Oh, this is a wonderful speech. I'm so happy that you chose it. I think it's your turn, yeah. This is a defense. There was a court case in the 19th century. And I can't remember the details of it, but the defense attorney gave this beautiful speech to try to exonerate his client. No, it was the prosecution. This is the prosecutor's speech because somebody killed this guy's dog. And so this is the speech by the lawyer saying why the dog murderer should be convicted.
Gentlemen of the jury, the best friend of a man has in the world might turn against him and become his enemy. His son or daughter that he has reared with loving care might prove ungrateful. Those who are nearest and dearest to us, those whom we trust with our happiness and our good name, may become traitors to their faith. The money that a man has, he may lose. It flies away from him, perhaps when he needs it most. A man's reputation may be sacrificed in a moment of inconsiderate action. The people who are prone to fall on their knees to us honor when success is with us may be the first to throw the stone of malice when failure settles its cloud upon our heads. The one absolutely unselfish friend that man can have in this selfish world, the one that never deserts him, the one that never proves ungrateful or treacherous, is his dog. A man's dog stands by him in prosperity and in poverty, in health and in sickness. He will sleep on the cold ground where the wintry winds blow and the snow drives fiercely, and if only maybe near his master's side. He will kiss the hand that has no food to offer. He will lick the wounds and sores that come in encounters with the roughness of the world. He guards the sleep of his pauper master as if he were a prince. When all other friends desert, he remains. When the rich estate swings and reputation falls to pieces, he is constant in his love as the sun in journey through the heavens. If fortune drives the master forth, an outcast in the world, friendless and homeless, the faithful dog has no higher privilege than the rule of accompanying him his enemy. And where the last scene of all comes, that takes his master in its embrace, and his body is laid away in the cold ground, no matter if all other friends pursue their way, there by the graveside will be the noble dog to be found, his head between his paws, his eyes sad but open in an alert watchfulness, faithful and true even in death.
So next we have Maya, who is going to do Haile Selassie's speech at the UN from 1963. Represents 32 African nations before the UN, and this factoid, this speech is the basis for Bob Marley's song War.
Last May in Addis Ababa, I convened a meeting of heads of African state and government. In 3 days, the 32 nations represented at the conference that demonstrated to the world that when the will and the determination exist, nation and people of diverse background can and will work together. In unity to the achievement of common goal and the assurance of that equality and brotherhood which we desire. On the question of racial discrimination, the Addis Ababa conference taught to those we will learn this further lesson. that until the philosophy which holds on race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned. That until there are no longer first class and second class citizens of any nation. That until the color of a man's skin is of no more significance than the color of his eyes. That until the basic human rights are equally granted to all without regard to race. That until that day, the dream of lasting peace and world citizenship, of the rule of international morality will remain but a fleet illusion to be pursued but never attained. And until the ignoble and unhappy regimes that hold our brother in Angola, in Mozambique, in South Africa, in subhuman bondage have been toppled and destroyed. Until bigotry and prejudice and malicious and inhuman self-interest have been replaced by understanding and tolerance and goodwill. Until all Africans stand and speak as free beings, equal in the eyes of all men, as they are in the eyes of heaven. Until that day, the African continent will not know peace. We, Africans, will fight if necessary, and we know that we shall win, as we are confident in the victory of good over evil.
Okay, now the next one is Alexander and Heralds. Yes, and you haven't told us which one you want to do. Alexander? Yay, okay, great. Tell us. He's just doing tequila. Oh, you opened, okay. Open to any requests from the audience?
Hitler!
Jesus!
Lewis! Nate! Is anyone doing clueless?
It's a little fast. Is anyone doing
one? Clueless?
Would you like to do that? Come and put your leg down.
So this is a Chaplin speech from 1940, from the great dictator.
I'm sorry, but I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone if possible. Jew, gentle, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are all like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate and despise one another. In this world, there is room for everyone, and the good on earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned man's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical. Our cleverness has hardened kind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. The airplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in man. Cries out for universal brotherhood and for the unity in us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions through millions of despairing men, women, and little children, victims of a system that takes man, torture, and imprisons innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us, but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way for human progress, the hate of man will pass and dictators die. And the power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as man died, liberty will never perish. Soldiers, don't give yourself to brute men who despise you and enslave you, who regiment your lives, tell you what to do, what you think and what to feel, who drill you, diet you, treat you like cattle, and use you as cannon fodder. Don't give yourself to these unnatural machine men with machine minds and hearts. You are not machines, you are not cattle, you are man. You have a love of humanity in your hearts. You don't hate, only the unloved hate, the unloved and the unnatural. Soldiers, don't fight for slavery, fight for liberty. In the 17th chapter of St. Luke, it's written, the kingdom, not man or group of men, but in all men, in you. You, the people, have the power to create machines, the power to create happiness. You, the people, have the power to make this life free and beautiful, to make this life a wonderful adventure. Then, in the name of democracy, let us use that power, let us fight for a new world, a decent world that will give men a chance to work, that will give youth a future and old age a security. By the promise of these things, brutes have risen to power, but they lie, they do not fulfill their promise, they never will. Dictators free themselves, but they are enslaved the people. Now, let us fight, fulfill that promise. Let us fight to free the world, to do away with national barriers, to do away with greed, with hate and intolerance. Let us fight for a world of reason, a world where science and progress will lead to all man's happiness. Soldiers, in the name of all democracy, let us all unite!
Fantastic. So next up is our own good leader, Gabrielle. Number 74, Freedom or Death. This is a fantastic speech from 1913. By the way, could one of our team bring us another piece of paper for signing up? So that, yes, correct.
Here as a soldier who has temporarily left the field of battle in order to explain, it seems strange, it should have to be explained, what civil war is like when civil war is waged by women. I'm not only here as a soldier temporarily absent from the field of battle, I'm here, and that I think is the strangest part of my coming, I'm here as a person who, according to the law courts of my country, it has been decided is of no value to the community at all. And I'm adjudged because of my life to be a dangerous person under sentence of penal servitude in a convict prison. It is not at all difficult if revolutionaries come to you from Russia, if they come to you from China, or from any other part of the world, if they are men. But since I am a woman, it is necessary to explain why women have adopted revolutionary methods in order to win the rights of citizenship. We women, in trying to make our case clear, always have to make, as part of our argument, and urge upon men in our audience, the fact, a very simple fact, that women are human beings. You won your freedom in America when you had the revolution by bloodshed, by sacrificing human life. You won the Civil War by the sacrifice of human life when you decided to emancipate the Negro. You have left it to women in your land. The men of all civilized countries have left it to women to work out their own salvation. That is the way in which we women of England are doing. Human life for us is sacred. But we say, if any life is to be sacrificed, it shall be ours. We don't do it ourselves, but we will put the enemy in the position where they will have to choose between giving us freedom or giving us death.
Not just to students, but to previous speakers on previous days. You can all come and do this. The sign-up sheet is here. So next, we have Anne. Anne, who is going to do Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. 1963.
three, and this is a 5-minute speech, so this is going to be a tour de force.
Let's try.
Karaoke, the difficult part is dealing with a remote control.
And with 5 minutes.
You got it.
Okay. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day, on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slaves' owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. Yes, I do. I have a dream that one day, down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day this, right there, little will be able to join hands with little boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be excelled, and that every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope, and this is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. And this will be the day, this will be the day when all God's children will be able to sing with new meaning. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. And so let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening elderlies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that. Let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring, look out, mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we allow freedom to ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city,
We will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing the words of the old Negro spiritual, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last."
Said, we're truly one of the greatest speeches ever. So next, Joanna, who's going to be doing Jesus. Joanna for Jesus, it'd be like Jews for Jesus. Joanna for Jesus is going to do the Sermon on the Mount, possibly from AD 32. Like some tequila before doing Jesus. That's
blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs in the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you.
Ending there, but now we have Karin, who is going to do Demosthenes, 330 BC, known as the greatest political speech in Greek history. Finish it off. No, knock it all back. Nobody wants it once you've started it. Make it all. Save our dream.
I was never known to march through the city with a face of joy and exultation at the success of a foreign power. Embracing and announcing the joyful tidings to those who, I supposed, would transmit it to the proper place. I was never known to receive the successes of my own country with tremblings, with sighings, with eyes bending to the earth, like those impious men who are the defamers of the state, as if by such conduct they were not defamers of themselves, who look abroad and, when a foreign potentate has established his power on the calamities of Greece, applaud the event and tell us we should take every means to perpetuate his power. Hear me, ye immortal gods, and let not these their desires be ratified in heaven. Infuse a better spirit into these men. Inspire even their minds with purer sentiments. This is my first prayer. Or, if their natures are not to be reformed on them, only discharge your vengeance. Pursue them both by land and sea. Pursue them even to destruction. But to us display your goodness in a speedy deliverance from impending evils and all the blessings of protection and tranquility.
Okay. We only have one more person signed up, and yeah, this can run for another 20 minutes or so, so please participate. Next we have Mira, who is going to do the share speech from Clueless, another modern classic.
Woo!
This is from Clueless is what? 19, oh no. Here is Clueless. Oh, here we are. It's 1995.
Let all oppressed people be allowed refuge in America. Amber will take the composition. Cher will be pro. Cher, do this.
So, okay, like right now, for example, the Haitians need to come to America. But some people are all like, what about strain on our resources? But it's like when I had this garden party for my father's birthday, right? I said RSVP because it was a sit-down dinner. But people came that like did not RSVP. I was like totally bugging. I had to haul ass and kitchen the food and squish in extra place settings. But by the end of the day, it was like the more the merrier. And so, if the government could just go into the kitchen, rearrange some things, we could certainly party with the Haitians. And conclusion, may I please remind you that does not RSVP on the Statue of Liberty. Thank you.
Okay, we have Osama bin Laden next, performed by Joaquin. Joachim did not supply a number, which is number 8. So this is the speech from October 2004, an explanation of attacks.
Based upon the follows guidance, people of the United States, this call for mine is for you and concerns the ideal way to prevent another Manhattan and deals with war and its cause and results. Before I begin, I say to you that security is an indispensable pillar in human life, and the free men do not forfeit the security, contrary Bush claims that we hate freedom. If so, then let him explain why we did not strike, for example, Sweden. And we know that freedom haters do not possess defiant spirits like those of the 19. May Allah have mercy on them. Now we might fight because we are free men who do not sleep under oppression. We want to restore freedom to our nation, and just you lay waste to our nation, so we lay waste to yours. But I am amazed at you. Even though we are in the fourth year after the events of September 11, Bush is still engaged in distortion, deception, and hiding from you the real cause, and thus the reasons are still there for a repeat of what occurred. So I shall talk to you about the story behind those events, and I shall tell you truthfully about the moments in which the decisions was taken for you to consider. I say to you, Allah knows that I had never occurred to us the strike towers. But after it became unbearable and we witnessed the oppression and tyranny of the America-Israeli coalition against our people in Palestine and Lebanon, it came to my mind the events that affected my soul in a difficult way started in 1982 when America permitted the Israelis to invade Lebanon, and the American Sixth Fleet helped them in that. And the whole world saw and heard, but did not respond. In those difficult moments, many hard to describe ideas bubbled in my soul, but in the end, they produced intense feelings of rejection, of tyranny, and gave birth to a strong resolve to punish the oppressors. And as I looked at those demolished towers in Lebanon, it entered my mind that we should punish the oppressors in kind, that we destroy towers in America in order that they taste some of what we tasted, and so that they be deterred from killing our women and children. We have not found it difficult to deal with the Bush administration in light of the resemblance in bears to regimes in our countries, and half of which are ruled by the military, and the other half of which are ruled by the sons of kings and presidents. Our experience with them is lengthy, and both types are replete with those who are characterized by pride, arrogance, greed, and misappropriation of wealth. This resemblance began after the visits of Bush Sr. to the region at the time when some of the compatriots were dazzled by America and hoping that these visits would have been the effect on our countries. All of a sudden, he was affected by these monarchies and military regimes and became jealous of them remaining decades in the position to embezzle the public wealth of nation without supervision or accounting. So he took dictatorship and suppression of freedoms to his sons, and they named it Patriot Act, under the pretenses of fighting terrorism. In addition, Bush sanctioned the installation of sons and state governors and did not forget to import expertise in election fraud from presidents of Florida to be made use in for moments of difficulty. All that we have mentioned has made it easier for us to provoke and bait this administration. And, for the record, we have agreed with the commander of General Mohammed Atta. Allah have mercy on him, and all the operations should be carried out within 20 minutes before Bush and his administration's notice. It never occurred to us that the commander-in-chief of the armed forces would abandon 50,000 of his citizens in the Twin Towers to face those great honors alone at a time when they most needed him. But because it seemed to him that occupying himself by talking to little girl about the goat and his butt was more important than occupying himself with the planes and their butting of the skyscrapers, we were given 3 times the periodical required to execute the operations, all price due to Allah.
You know, where we were talking about awkwardness earlier, there's something to be said for, you know, in the context of Dutch Islamophobia, for thinking about how these speeches sound now. So let's, on that note, let's go straight to Colonel Gaddafi and see how this is done by, I'll read this name, Dorfina?
Dear brothers, as you know, the United Nations was established and founded by 3 countries who were against the Germans at the time. The United Nations that we have today is different, but the United Nations, it is the countries of Germany during the Second World War. These countries built council and gave member seats to its own members, and the grant, the veto, we were not present at the time. And the United Nations was tailored according to these countries and wanted to wear the suit that was tailored against Germany. That is the real substance and context of the United Nations as it was founded 60 years ago. This happened during the absence of over 165 countries where the ratio was on the 8 and 1 was present and 8 were absent. Those created or they made the Carter copy of it. And the one should read the Carter of the United Nations to PMable of the United Nations is different from the provisions and the articles. How this came to be, those who attended in San Francisco in 1945, they all participated in the PMable, but they left the articles and the provisions and the procedures to the internal procedures of the Security Council. They left it in the job of the experts and the countries who are interested, which are the countries who created the Security Council, which countries came together united against Germany. The preamble is very seductive, and no one is objecting to the preamble, but everything that came after that is completely in contradiction with the preamble. This is what we have now, this is what we are rejecting, and should never continue. The preamble says that the nations are equal, whether they are small or big. Are we equal in the permanent seats? No, we are not equals. And the preamble says that all the nations are equal, whether they are small nations, whether they are big nations, as far as rights. Do we have rights of a veto? Are we equals? The preamble says that we are equals and our rights, whether we are big or small. This is what is stated, and this is what we have agreed to in the preamble. So, the veto is against the Charter. The permanent seats are against the Charter. We do not accept it, and we do not recognize it. The preamble states that we should not resort to military force unless it is in common interest. This is the preamble which we are happy signed, and we joined the United Nations because we wanted the Charter to be like that. It says that the armed forces only use it when it's common interest to all nations. But after that, what happened? 65 wars broke out after the establishment of the United Nations and after the establishment of the Security Council. And after this, the establishment is 65, and the victims are millions more than the victims of the Second World War. Are these wars and the aggressions and the force that were used in the 65 wars in the common interest of all of us? No. It was in of the particular country, two countries or three countries, but it was not in the interest of all the nations.
As you might remember, it's actually an excerpt of a 3 or 4 hour speech that was done at the UN. Next up, Barack Obama, performed by Anton. Oh, Aaron, we've got a rebooting question. In the meantime, I was going to ask whether you would like a brief Q&A at the end of this. Do you have questions for Annie, or do you just want to end with Okie? Just a general sense, not to ask your questions now, but put your hand up if you are in favor of a handful of questions at the end. 1, 2, 3. Okay, that's enough. We'll have 5 minutes of questions. Democracy in action. Okay, so here we go. Anton, and it's the Obama number 7. This is the on illegal wiretapping speech from 2007, where he criticizes the Bush administration for spying on US citizens and ironically vowing to end the practice if elected.
This is an attempt that also puts forever feels chose between liberties, crisis. I'm a property instilling in the world. I'm so re-blind. This would be really hard to do.
Next up, Brenda is going to do Margaret Thatcher, number 87. This is the Free Society speech from 1975.
Numbers in a state computer. We believe that they should be individuals. We are all unequal. No one, thank heavens, is quite like anyone else. However, much the socialists may pretend, can't keep up with that, we believe that everyone has the right to be unequal. But it is every human being. A man's right to work as he will, to spend what he earns, own property, to have the state as servant and not as master. They are the essence of a free economy. And on that freedom, thanks. All our other freedoms depend. Cheers. was that it?
Oh. last one is the Pussy Riot speech. So this brings us beautifully full circle to yesterday. And this is Minna, right?
Yeah.
I pronounced your name, good. And so this is the closing statement for the trial for the performance of the punk prayer from 2012.
Essentially, it's not three singers from Pussy Riot who are on trial here. If that were the case, what's happening would be totally insignificant. It is the entire state system of the Russian Federation which is on trial and which is, unfortunately for itself, thoroughly enjoys quoting its cruelty towards human beings, its indifference to their honor and their dignity. Very first, Russian history to date. To my deepest regret, this mock trial is closed to the standards of the Stalinist Troikos. Thus, we have our investigator, lawyer, and judge. And then, what's more, what all three of them do and say and decide is determined by political demand for repression. Who is to blame for the performance at the Cathedral of Christ the Savior and for our being put on trial after the concert? The authoritarian political system is to blame. What Pussy Riot does is oppositional art or politics that draw upon the form art has established. In any event, it's a form of civil action in circumstances where basic human rights, civil and political freedoms, are suppressed by the corporate state system. We were looking for authentic genuineness and simplicity, and we found them in our punk performances. Passion, openness, and naivety are superior to hypocrisy, cunning and contrived decency that conceals crimes. The state's leaders stand with saintly expressions in church, but their sins are far greater than ours. We've put on our political punk concerts because the Russian state system is dominated by rigidity, closeness, and caste. And the policies pursue its interest to the extent that even the air of Russia makes us ill. And every day, more and more people realize that this political system has ganged up to this extent against three girls for 30 seconds performance in the Cathedral of Christ the Savior. It means the system is afraid of the truth and afraid of our sincerity and directness. We haven't disassembled, not for a second, not for a minute during this trial, but the other side is dissembling too much. And people can sense it. People can sense the truth. Truth really does have some kind of ontological, existential superiority over in the Bible over the old, in particular. In the end, the ways of truth always triumph over the ways of wickedness, guile, and lies. And with each day that passes, the ways of truth are more and more triumph, even though we are still behind bars and likely to be here a lot longer yet. Perhaps they think it wouldn't be a bad thing to send us to jail because we are rising up against Putin and his system as well, but they can't say so because that's not allowed either. Their mouths are soon shut. Unfortunately, they are mere puppets. I hope they realize this and also take the road to freedom, truth, and sincerity, because these are superior to stasis, contrived decency, and hypocrisy. Stasis and the search for truth are always in opposition to one another, and in this case, at this trial, we can see people who are trying to find the truth and people who are trying to enslave those who want to find the truth. Finally, I'd like to quote a Pussy Riot song, because strange as it may seem, all our songs have turned out to be prophetic, including the one that says the KGB chief, their number one saint, will escort protesters off to jail. That's us.
What I'd like to quote now, however, is the next line. Open the doors, off with the shoulder straps, join us in the taste of freedom.
Fantastic. Thank you, everyone. And now we have just 5 minutes for a few questions, if people have them. Who put their hand up earlier? You will now be returned to. Yes, down at the front.
You studied all these speeches, or like you read all these speeches and like, put them in a nice karaoke format. Did you notice any kind of change through speeches, through time? Not just like, because I see in Germany we have a big debate going on about like, are there actual political speeches still left? At least in Germany there hardly are, because politicians seem to be more and more afraid to actually say something with content. They just try to avoid answering questions and giving statements. So I saw that, for instance, the Obama speech was given unintentionally, which is nice. Did you notice something like that, or is it like a phenomenon that kind of we observe?
Yeah, it's a little unfair to say on the basis of this, because I chose, so, you know, I selected very much, so you don't get any sense of you don't necessarily get a true sense of any change over time. I mean, of course, there have been, like, you can't say, you know, we go from the beauty of Socrates, you know, to Clueless. And that's that's an unfair kind of idea. But of course, there are studies for sure, like about that the, at least in the U.S., these studies I know that the reading level that different political speeches are aimed at has declined in the last 25 years or something. So that you have, you know, Lyndon Johnson speaking at a kind of a last year of high school reading level, and by the time you get to Obama and Bush, it's like an eighth grade reading level for most of their. A 12-year-old. Yeah.
How's it about the length? Are they getting shorter?
I don't know that I can make those kinds of generalizations. I mean, there's certainly not from this selection anyway. You wouldn't be able to make those kind of generalizations. I think there's no question you can say, generally speaking, in terms of cultural criticism, which, you know, many, many people have written about, that there's a kind of dumbing down of the culture, at least in terms of certain kinds of literacy. But it may be that it's not this, linear process, that there's something like an extraordinarily ornate way of speaking that appears in the 19th century that declines very rapidly in the 20th century, possibly in reaction to the ornateness of 19th century discourse. You know, I mean, so these things are not necessarily linear, like, and then it comes into other kinds of changes culturally about the rise of mass media and print culture, and then the you know, introduction of television, so the speeches are made for TV instead of for people to read in the newspaper, and all those kinds of changes, yeah.
Thank you.
Next question. Oh yes, in the red.
But like the, you know, for example, this Pussy Riot speech I think is more beautiful than many things written hundreds of years ago, like, you know, and more intelligent and coherent, so.
Yeah, I was wondering on what basis you made a selection of the speeches.
Yeah, it started out, I was very rigorous in the beginning. Like, it started with me looking a lot at lists of greatest speeches of different countries and, you know, most famous speeches politically. And, you know, so I took kind of like top 25, you know, by the time, like the first 50 speeches, I would say, I really chose on the basis of the most well-known. I was asking many people for their top 10 speeches, things they could remember, you know. And then by the last 40 of them, I started getting a bit more all over the place. Like, I started thinking about different countries or different kinds of speech. Like, I thought I would not use anything fictional, but then at the end I decided to throw two Shakespeare speeches in. I sort of relaxed my own standards towards the end. I was shooting for 100 total. And at most, I think I had 95, and then I cut 5 because they weren't any good. But it was really, like I said, it was a much bigger pain in the ass making them than I expected. So it was a little bit like being in an assembly line. Like, I spent really many hours, and you sort of go a little bit mad. And so then I started adding things like the clueless speech and stuff like that. To
then there's a question behind, if you could pass the mic back.
Hi, I really enjoyed that. I just thought that normal karaoke really relies on you really loving a song and really knowing it well enough to go, yeah, I'm gonna go and sing that song. So I thought it's an incredible challenge to make people select something at random almost. I guess there are probably a few people who chose something that they thought, I really want to do that. And I thought that possibly in most cases, the speech almost controls the speaker, but there were one or two where I think people already owned the speech and even went ahead of the, I think it was Gabriella who went ahead of the auto cue, which I thought was quite powerful, and I felt like that it meant something to her as she was doing it. But I'd kind of be kind of interested to maybe hear from one or two people about the experience of doing it, because I was too chicken to give it a go. But you know, I appreciate how, like, it must have been quite scary, or it could have been exciting, I don't know.
Great idea. Do any of the participants want to comment on their experience? Yes, several hands. What if this, Thatcher, I believe, would like to say something. And who else put their hand up? Martin Luther King, yes.
Hi.
Yeah, it's actually also something I wanted to ask you about, how you see people change, because you have many different people that do this, probably, like when they perform this. And, well, to react on how it was, for me, it was really, well, my decision was based on that I knew the speech, or well, that I heard of it, and I actually never saw it in its complete form. It was the first time that I read it all. But it's also the fact that you just stand there and everybody's watching you, and normally with karaoke people sing along, and it's not that everybody was like, yeah, I have a dream, or like, I was just on my own. And the sort
there was
of
applause. There was a lot of enthusiastic applause at the right moment.
Yeah, no, but it was but also to carry me through it in that sense. But with karaoke, you just, well, like when you mess up the words, you just go like la la, and with this, you just you are very conscious of messing up, and you also, because it's historically very known and it's has been very important, you also want to carry that baggage of the text. So I think that's something that I wanted to say.
Nice. You pass the mic down to Margaret Thatcher.
Yeah, of course.
This lady's turning.
Actually, I'm really quite shy. So this was a really big thing for me to do. And I just thought it would be really novel, somebody who's from the north with a northern accent, to have a go at a Margaret Thatcher speech. I knew nobody would like it. I knew that it would be probably pretty hard to do because I wouldn't have the backing of the audience. And actually, I suddenly realized, fuck, what am I doing? This is totally against my principles, everything. Why am I actually recounting something that I'm so very opposed to?
You know, I completely empathize, because the first time I saw this, I went straight for the Thatcher speech as well. I wanted to confront the enemy by doing it.
Yeah. Yeah. But it was almost to ridicule it, but actually it was so short, you couldn't get your teeth into it. So I was kind of, I was so nervous before the actual going onto the podium, because the other guy just deafed out, and I was just thinking, what am I gonna do? And I actually was quite surprised that I turned my back on the audience, because I couldn't cope with looking at them.
I mean, this is one of the things that I really have to say I didn't necessarily predict about this piece when I was making it, and that's become my favorite thing about it, which
is
the surprise. Like, that sometimes people think they're going to be stronger than the speech. For example, some people do like an Anders Breivik or the Bin Laden or something like that, and they think they're going to be able to conquer it. they're gonna be able to make fun of it, they're gonna be able to show their distance from it. And the act of speaking the words has a big impact.
It had a massive
impact. And the
big,
the act of having the, an audience hearing those words has a big effect. So you end up getting a little schooled, I think, by thinking that you can actually control the rhetoric. And I, you know, there's a great, there's one speech in here by Margaret Sanger, who was an early 20th century feminist and birth control rights activist, and a eugenicist who had some weird ties to the Ku Klux Klan. So one of the things that I enjoy very much, even though it's, you know, awful, is having particularly white women do the Margaret Sanger speech, because they think it's going to be really rah-rah wonderful, and then I chose something that's a little bit showing the other side of Margaret Sanger, and everyone, you know, you discover it as you're speaking.
Yeah.
So there's this kind of strange transformation. Anyway,
we are being invaded.
Yes.
I want it's you scary, to give a massive round of applause to everyone who participated in the Spokaoke. Thank you for coming and listening, and this is the final performance of the festival.